So, as I said in class today, I wanted to do another example associated with critical point finding and second derivative testing associated with multivariate functions, right? So, the first things that we need to do is we need to recall that the critical points will be found by setting the first derivative of the multivariate function. So critical points here, I'm assuming f is a function that takes in two variables and spits out three, right? It's a mapping from R2 to R. Right? So we associate that with a two-dimensional surface living in three-dimensional space. And how we, of course, find the critical points of this is we set the first derivative of the function, in this language here, the gradient, to the partial of f with respect to x and the partial of f with respect to y equal to 0. And that is the 0 vector, right? So what we're talking about here is 0 and 0. Now, that will figure out places for which the tangent plane is a constant plane, right? It's not oriented in any way in space so that it's going vertically. It's just this horizontal plane at some z value. And so we have this second derivative test which is conducted by taking the determinant of the Hessian matrix, so the determinant of H, and so this is the determinant of this 2x2 matrix, which is populated with all of the second derivatives. Something that looks like this. Right. So, there is a trichotomy that comes out of this, or actually, sorry, a dichotomy that comes out of this, where if this number is greater than 0, then what we're talking about here is some sort of local max or min. And if it's less than 0, then what we're talking about here is a minimax or saddle. I don't want to get into it too much. You can look at Wikipedia, and there are some good statements about the geometric implications for the 2D case, for the two-dimensional surface living in three-dimensional space. But really, a goal that we kind of have on the back burner here is how can we abstract this to higher dimensions, and is there a standard way to do that, and what does that standard way mean? And so a lot of those arguments that go on in a place like Wikipedia or something that I would conduct in class tend to go on, and not everyone is really gets what they need out of it. Right, so let's just take this as the truth of the matter, right? That the determinant of this Hessian, the Hessian being the matrix H here, that carries all of the second partial information, that's really just what we need to look at. And somehow that number that comes out of this is telling us about whether or not we have a bowl that's concave up, a bowl that's concave down, or something like one of these saddle objects, right? The saddle object is the minimax, and that's a new structure for a surface, right? We normally don't have that sort of thing for first derivative problems. Or, I mean, for single variable problems. Okay, so alright, so we want to work on the following problem through this technique. I want to look at f of xy is equal to 2x cubed plus xy squared plus 5x squared plus y squared. I want to find the critical points of this multivariate polynomial, and then I want to test with a Hessian the critical points to determine whether they're local maxes or mins, or a minimax like a saddle. To give you an idea of what this surface looks like, we have the following diagram. Okay. This is the object. If you look at it, right, from the side right here, you kind of see a cubic nature to it, which is common, right? And then when you look in this direction, right, you can we see some parabolic sorts of curves. And that's because this thing is being assembled from a multivariate polynomial. Right? So what I see with this multivariate polynomial right away is that it appears to me that in here there's some sort of local min, here there's some sort of local max, and then we probably have some sort of saddle sitting right here. So it might be a situation where you're sitting right here, right? This piece is kind of keeping you in the seat, and then your legs are hanging out these sides, right? So we want to see if we can find that through the calculus. Okay, so the first thing that we do, of course, is we take the gradient of f. Taking the gradient of f, right, I'm going to assemble a vector full of first partial derivatives, all of the first partial derivatives that I can take. Right, so the first partial with respect to x and the first partial with respect to y. Taking the first partial with respect to x, I get a 2 times 3, so that's a 6x squared. Plus, take the derivative of this term with respect to x to get a y squared. Take the derivative of this with respect to x to get a 10x. And then take a derivative here with respect to x, and it vanishes. Now we do the same on y. This term goes away. Then I have a 2xy. Then I add to that. This term goes away, and then I have a 2y. Okay, that's the gradient, and I set this gradient equal to the zero vector to find the critical points, in analogy with what we do from Calc 1. So this gives me a system of equations. The system of equations looks like 6x squared plus y squared plus 10x is equal to 0. And then another equation, 2xy plus 2y, and that one is also equal to 0. What we see from this is we typically get nonlinear systems of equations, right? Nonlinear systems of equations can be very difficult to solve, especially by hand, right? And so oftentimes these problems are cooked up. They start from a multivariate polynomial, and then they get to some sort of system of nonlinear equations that hopefully submits to a hand calculation. So when I see this system, I try to look for simplifications. The first thing I notice is in the second equation, I can factor the y off. I look for factors because I'm trying to set things equal to zero. And if I factor, right, especially the y's off of the x's, then I get a situation where either this y has to be 0, or this 2x plus 2 has to be 0. So now I set this equal to 0, and the implication here is that y is equal to 0, or x is equal to negative 1. And that's what has to be true for the second equation to be 0. So let's take a look at the implications this has in the first equation. So say I set y equal to 0. If I set y equal to 0, then for y equals 0, the implication on the first equation is that it looks like 6x squared plus 10x is equal to 0, right? I'm not going to write that 0 because what do I notice here again? I notice that an x can be factored off, leaving me with a 6x plus 10 is equal to 0. And so the implication here is that x could be 0 or x could be equal to, let's see, negative 10 divided by 6, and negative 5/3. Okay. And that's enough to give me 2 points, right? Point one is, okay, what's true about both of these points? Both of these points spawn from the y equals 0 case. Right. One of the points is 0 for x. The other is negative 5/3, right? So both of these purple situations come out of the fact that I'm demanding that y be 0, which sets the second equation up to be 0. Now, I need both of the equations to be 0 simultaneously, so by demanding that y is 0, I revisit the first equation, setting y equal to 0. Now y is gone, and I'm solving for the x value that would make the first equation 0 now that the second equation is already 0. Right? This is quadratic in the x variable, so I get two x values that make that happen. Okay. What's missing now is there's all this work associated with x being equal to negative 1. Let's put that right here. If x equal to -1, then going back to the first equation, let's maybe make that orange so we know we're going back there. If x is equal to -1, I have 6 times -1 squared plus y squared minus 10, right? Is equal to, okay, so that's what, 6 minus 10, so that's y squared minus 4 is equal to 0. Is that right? Negative 10 plus 6? Sure. And so this tells me that y is equal to plus or minus 2. Right? So now point 3 is the point where x is equal to negative 1, and then y is equal to 2, and then point 4 is the point where x is equal to negative 1 and y is equal to negative 2. Okay. So this is what's necessary for the second equation to be equal to 0. Now when I shove that stuff back into the first equation, this is the list of points that I have found so that the first equation is also simultaneously 0. Alright, so since I've exhausted both of these options here for equation 2 into equation 1, I'm done. I can't set equation 2 equal to 0 without making this happen. So those have to be all my points. Okay. What I bet is going on here is that revisiting the surface, right? I bet 0, 0 is down in the bucket. I bet 0, negative 5 thirds is up in the this peak. And then I bet the saddles have the symmetry of negative 1, 2, and negative 1, negative 2. So I bet these guys are the saddles. How do I know that? Well, just going to have to figure it out through the second derivative test. So, for the second derivative test, what we want to do is we want to go back through. Notice that this is f sub x. This is f sub y. And so, let's just do the work to find f sub x, x. F sub x, x, right? Let me color this in red. Right? It spawns from this red one. I take another derivative of this thing with respect to x, so I get a 12x. I take a derivative of this with respect to x, and it goes away. And then I get a 10, taking the derivative of 10x with respect to x. Okay, now f sub y, y. This will be Christmas green here, now that I'm in reds and greens. Take another derivative of this guy with respect to y. Taking a derivative of the first term with respect to y leaves me with a 2x, and a derivative of the second term with respect to y leaves me with a 2. Now, they're cross. They're mixed, right? Bye-bye, orange. So now, I'm going to start with red, which is f sub x, and differentiate again on y. This first term goes away, the second term becomes 2y. And the third term goes away. What you might notice is you could start with green and take a derivative now with respect to x, take f sub y and take a derivative with respect to x. You will get a 2y right here, and this term will go away. What we're saying is that this is a continuous function, and by Clairaut's theorem, those cross partials are the same thing. Okay, so what we have going on here then, all together, is a definition of the Hessian matrix, which is equal to x plus 10, 2y, 2y, and then 2x plus 2. That is my Hessian. Now what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to have to evaluate the Hessian at these points. Okay. So, say, let's see if I can get enough colors cooked out here. So I have the Hessian evaluated at point 1, which is equal to the Hessian being evaluated at 0, 0. And the Hessian at that point is 0 times 12, leaving me plus a 10. 2 times 0, which is a 0. 2 times 0, which is a 0. And then 2 times 0 plus 2, which is a 2. Okay, so the determinant of this Hessian at P1 is equal to upper left times lower right minus lower left times upper right, which is equal to 20. And that is decidedly greater than 0. Since it's greater than 0, I could be a local max or a local min. Right, to know whether it's a local max or min, I have to know whether this surface is concave up or concave down. To know whether it's concave up or concave down means that I should just check one of these two second partials. Right, so I know that f sub xx is greater than 0. How do I know that? Well, it's sitting right there. For that matter, this is f sub yy at that point. F sub yy is also greater than 0. So whatever structure is sitting there is concave up, right? And if it's concave up, and we're in the Hessian determinant category that speaks to a local max or min, this means that this is a local min, as the bowl is concave up around that point. Okay, next test. So that's test one. Test two, right? I have h of p2. That is h of negative 5/3 and 0. So this is going to be my y's are 0. So the Hessian matrix on the upper right and lower left are going to be 0. Now, if x is negative 5/3, right, I have 12 times negative 5/3 plus 10. Oh, I didn't leave myself enough room there. It's all right. So then I have 2 times negative 5/3 plus 2. Let's rework this a little bit. Reworking it, what, 12 is 4 times 3, so this 3's canceled, so this is negative, or 4 times negative 5. So that's going to be negative 20 plus another 10. So that should be a negative 10 in that component. Now, what? This is negative 10/3 plus 2, which is 6/3. So this right here is negative 10/3 plus 6/3. So this is negative 4/3. Okay. The determinant of this Hessian at point 2... It's definite, or well, let's just calculate it, right? It's positive, but what is it? It's negative 10 times negative 4 is a 40/3, which is positive, okay? So this again speaks to a local max or a local min, but we also notice that f sub xx is less than 0, and f sub yy is less than 0. Therefore, we are talking about concave down. In both directions, and so we're talking about a local max. Okay. Let's see, how much real estate do I have to do this last calculation? Okay, I think I can do this last calculation right here. So, expediting this, let's do the Hessian evaluated at negative 1 or plus 2 or minus 2. Let's just do both at the same time. Let's see what happens here. The Hessian there is going to be, okay, if x is equal to negative 1, then I have negative 12 plus 10, leaving me with a negative 2. If y is equal to plus or minus 2, then I have plus or minus 4 sitting here. Remember that the plus is for the top argument. I'm doing two arguments at the same time, and the minus is for the second of the two. So I have plus or minus 4 here. And then let's see, if x is equal to negative 1, then negative 2 plus 2 is 0. So the implication then is the determinant of this Hessian is equal to negative 2 times 0. Minus, so let's write that out, right? negative 2 times 0 minus plus or minus 4 quantity squared. So this, no matter what, is always going to be negative 16, which is less than 0. At that point, no other testing is necessary. This is, for both points, P3 and P4, we're talking about a minimax. Or sal, whichever you want to call it. Okay, that went off screen, so down here, I'm saying minimax. Okay, that is the procedure of using the gradient to find critical points, and then using the Hessian and its determinant to decide where in this category we are. Whether we're a local max or min, which needs a little bit more concavity testing, or whether we're a minimax.